Good morning. Showers and storms expected. Warmer temperatures could make for a wet weekend. Also this morning, fog blankets east central Indiana. Coming up, the school delays and how it'll impact your morning and commute.
Yeah, all of this coming off of a strange week for weather. We went from snow in 20 degrees to 50 degrees in just a matter of days. We'll have the latest for you just ahead. Get the coffee ready and open up those eyes. You're waking up with Cardinal Weather.
From Ball State Unified Media, you're waking up with Cardinal Weather, live from the Ball State Weather Center.
Degrees on your Friday morning. Thanks for being with us. I'm Tanner Holbrook.
And I'm Tyler Brumman. Happy to be with you this morning.
And I'm Peyton Domschke. Thanks for joining us.
And as we mentioned in the headline, it is a blanket central Indiana. Several school delays. We want to get it right to Joe Struess, who has the latest on that for us this morning. Good morning, Joe.
Well, good morning, guys. Yeah, take a look out here over McKinley Avenue. It makes you want to just sit inside, have a cup of coffee this morning. I mean, I really would suggest that. This is just a gloomy, depressing day. It's a way to start your Friday, but at least it is Friday. Temperatures 40 degrees, that's a bonus. I mean, the last few days, we've been much cooler. Temperatures in the 20s and the 30s the last few days. So a bit of a welcome change, and we will see temperatures warm up as we head into the weekend. Speaking of the fog, conditions are improving just a little bit right now, starting to get visibilities back just a little bit. We expect dense fog to last through the morning hours. Dense fog advisory here in gray lasts through 10 a.m. this morning. And then up here in more of the teal color, Grant, Blackford, and Jay counties, you are in the freezing fog advisory due to some cooler temperatures there that would allow for the fog to actually create slick road conditions. That also expires at 10 a.m. this morning. We'll have an update on the fog as we head through the morning, and we're going to update you on your weekend forecast in just a few minutes.
All right, Joe, thank you so much. Love the mug, by the way. We do want to let you know that we will have those school delays running at the bottom of the screen throughout the morning. Meanwhile, flooding continues to ravage the areas of Northern California that were also affected by the wildfires. Several vehicles have been trapped on roads throughout northern parts of the state. The damaging waters began as officials were tracking large bands of rain just off the coast of Southern California. Those are raising concerns about the possibility of landslides. Residents in California are being urged to evacuate neighborhoods on the southeast side of Los Angeles. That's where wildfires occurred just last summer. Meanwhile, mandatory evacuations have already begun in the southwestern part of the state due to those threats of landslides.
Also this morning, hazards from above. Several streets and sidewalks in downtown Chicago were closed yesterday after melting ice and snow began to fall from high rises. Take a look at this stunning video. Large pieces of ice fell down from the top of the former John Hancock Center in the city's Gold Coast neighborhood, and it even smashed some car windows below. And thankfully, wow, the driver of that vehicle was not hurt. However, tourists Paige Weiss and Kevin McDowell were amazed at what they saw.
Sheets of ice and snow falling from the ledge.
Yeah, so we have a hotel room and we have a window facing the street, and I look out the window and we see large chunks of ice just falling, and I thought it was kind of strange because I thought it was going to be more like snowflakes, but that's a large snowflake.
Emergency planners urge pedestrians to make sure to look up and be observant. Now turning to that hurricane season, it's the end of that active 2018 hurricane season that produced a total of 15 named storms, including 8 hurricanes, and 2 of which were Category 3 or higher.
Yeah, Tanner, major hurricanes Florence and Michael dominated headlines earlier this year. Florence made landfall near Wilmington, North Carolina, and stalled over the area, producing record amounts of rainfall. Hurricane Michael made landfall 2 weeks later near Mexico Beach, Florida, making history as the strongest hurricane to strike the panhandle. Between the two hurricanes alone, damage costs could exceed $40 billion. Forecasters predicted a slightly above average hurricane season, estimating 13 to 18 named storms.
Yeah, and back now for an overview of the hurricane season is Joe Struess over here and Peyton Domschke. You know, this season really picked up at the very end. Several storms at the beginning of our semester in our coverage.
Right.
Why did we see that?
It's a typical time of the year to see an uptick in hurricane season is around September. It's a little bit more of a difficult answer. It's due to delayed heating in the Atlantic Ocean. You get a lot of hot weather in the summer months that results in delayed warming of the waters. So as the jet gets more dynamic in the start of fall, that mixes with the warmer waters
But even like Joe saying, these seasons vary year to year. There's no set year that's that we can predict that's going to be greater than one
over another. Which is interesting because I feel like this one is a little more volatile than years past. You know, especially we had those two Category 3 hurricanes, especially that one that popped out of nowhere and hit the southern United States and Mexico. So I just feel like it was a very, you know, volatile season.
I mean, it even goes to show that different places are affected by these hurricanes because with two of them, we did see ramifications here in the state of Indiana, as well as other coastal areas saw different effects, large, heavy amounts of water that had fallen there. But even here, the two, Gordon and then
Alberto, if you go back to May, near Memorial Day weekend, somewhere around there, we had actually the remnants of what was Tropical Storm Alberto make their way up to Indiana. It was kind of an interesting sight for some of us weather geeks, where you have
you were talking about how it just held its shape throughout.
It held its shape over Indiana. It's kind of interesting.
I mean,
to see
how rare
system.
Is that? It's pretty rare, right?
It's rare. It depends on really the dynamics. A lot of times you see the systems get sheared out, and like we saw with Tropical Storm Gordon, system sheared out. It doesn't have the same appearance, but we just got a lot of rain in the Midwest. So
it stuck with us. I mean, it had to progress all the way up inland. So it depends on what's going on here too, because if those conditions aren't right, it won't stick.
Yeah. Well, and I know that we do feel those effects as we have this past season. Very interesting stuff, especially how it just holds its shape. I don't know much about hurricanes, but I know that's pretty out of the ordinary.
I mean, we're all going to be happy that it's done and over with.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now we got to turn to winter storms, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess always so. Fun stuff. All right, hey, coming up, hear how a community in Indiana helped one family after they were displaced by a hurricane.
That's all after your weather now. Past the hour, still that fog is making some trouble for your morning commute.
Yeah.
Several delays this morning. Let's send it over to Joe and get your check of the weather. Joe?
We're not sending it to Joe. Hey!
What
have you?
Apparently Tyler's doing weather.
Yeah, so, no, I don't know anything about that. But hey, here's a cool story for you. It's the most wonderful time of the year, and it does come with festive lights, trees, and tasty holiday cooking. What many people don't think about are the dangers that can come with those decorations, according to the National Fire Protection Association. Between the years 2012 and 2016, there were an average of 170 house fires per year that started as a result of Christmas tree fires. There's some simple solutions to make sure that this type of disaster doesn't happen in your home. Dr. John Pritchell, Director of Emergency Management and Homeland Security, offered tips on how to prevent these types of disasters.
With regard to trees, you're asking for do's and don'ts, and one do is to buy a fresh tree if you're going to purchase a live tree, a fresh tree with intact needles. Make sure you get a fresh cut along the trunk, and it should be watered every day. I mean, it will take up moisture, and that will make a difference in terms of resistance to ignition.
And some definitely some useful information there for you this morning. Also this morning, an Indiana family is back in their hometown after moving to Florida and losing their home to a hurricane. The good news is that they're getting some help celebrating the holidays as they try to rebuild their lives. Kim Shine has the story this morning.
Most times, This Mishawaka police SWAT vehicle is used in dangerous situations, but on Monday it was filled with toys and officers wearing smiles.
I didn't know that the truck was coming like this.
12-year-old Jaden and his 9-year-old brother Malik getting an early Christmas with the help of Mishawaka police. The family lost everything to Hurricane Michael and are staying in a Mishawaka hotel as they work on their home in South Bend.
This is our boys' room right here. You can see their mattresses and stuff.
Lee Caldwell, who lives in Mishawaka, saw my original story and knew she could help.
I mean, they were going to be happy without any toys, and it just broke my heart. So I wanted to do something. I wanted to get our community involved.
Lee called our newsroom and asked if Mishawaka police would help deliver her grandson's toys. He has autism, like the couple's son Malik. She knew that he'd like them and that his brother Jaden would, too.
Well, God bless y'all, man.
It's nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you, too, brother.
I feel sad that we lost everything, but now we got a lot of stuff back from the nice people that just came right here.
My mind is still blown. Awesome. I'm like so excited, like there's gonna actually be help with Christmas.
It's our job to, you know, promote that, promote how good this community is to everybody. It just shows what this community is really about. It's a family in this community.
And again, that was Kim Shine reporting. What a cute story.
I know,
there.
Such a good story, especially for a family in need in the most wonderful time of the year. And apparently, now is the time for weather.
Are we sure?
Yeah, I don't know. I thought it was about a minute ago. Just kidding, Joe. Here you go.
Good morning, Tanner and Tyler. Yeah, it's all right. Sometimes we make mistakes. Things happen. A lot of fog outside right now. It is Friday morning, so you're weighing the good and the bad. You can see that we do have some school delays scrolling at the bottom of your screen. That is due to dense fog that we're seeing across the area. Temperature-wise, you will notice a difference as you head out the door today. Current temperatures in the low 40s to the south, 43 in Bloomington and Terre Haute. 28 in Lafayette and Champaign, a little cooler still up to the northwest, and in the mid-30s here in our area. It's definitely a little different than what we've seen the last few days as we've been waking up with temperatures a bit cooler than that. Our daytime highs the last few days we're a little bit closer to where we are this morning. Now, the other story this morning is the dense fog. We have a dense fog advisory in place for the counties in gray until 10 a.m. this morning. So definitely take it slow on the roads. Allow a little extra time as your commute may be a little bit challenging due to the fog. Up to the north in Grant, Blackford, and Jay counties, you see this teal color. That is for a freezing fog advisory that lasts until 10 a.m. as well. Temperatures were a little bit cooler there this morning, which would allow for the fog to freeze and actually create rather slick conditions out on the roads. Fortunately, as you saw in the current temperatures, it looks like temperatures are warming up above that freezing mark. Here's a look at our fog tracker right now. Visibility seemed to be improving a bit across our viewing area, but in some of the darker shades here, you can see where we do still have plenty of dense fog across the viewing area. It should lift as we head through the morning hours. Some rain showers were around early today up to the north. Those have dissipated quickly. I think we stay mostly dry for the rest of the day today. In terms of rainfall, there's a lot of rain on the way. We'll break it all down for you, but we could see upwards of an inch of rain across the viewing area through the day tomorrow. Stay tuned. We'll break down tomorrow's system and have a look at your 7-day forecast just coming up in a few minutes.
That's the weather I was looking for. All right, up next, we'll have an update to a story that caused millions across the country to check their refrigerators.
Yeah, you definitely won't want to miss it, but first we have your weather now. And welcome back to Waking Up with Cardinal Weather. It's 8:14 on your Friday morning. You're taking a live look right now outside down McKinley Avenue. A little bit of fog this morning that we're dealing with. And as we bring it back here into the studio, are we going to... No, we're not going to, Joe. We're actually taking a look at weather history. We're going to keep giving Tanner a hard time. We won't let him live this down. But on this date...
Shouldn't say a bad word.
On this date, back in 2016, a strong line of thunderstorms did move through the southeast United States, resulting in multiple tornado and damaging wind reports. Severe thunderstorm damage was seen across Louisiana, Florida, Alabama, Georgia, South Carolina, Tennessee, Virginia, and North Carolina. So a lot of places did see those thunderstorms there. Am I reading this one?
Also, the Food and Drug Administration is narrowing down the source of an E. coli outbreak linked to romaine lettuce. And if you don't know, I'm now a salad eater, so I'm kind of upset about this. The FDA announced Wednesday it's investigating six California counties as the source of the current outbreak. And previously, both the FDA and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention urged consumers to not eat any romaine lettuce. But now, the CDC is urging the public to avoid eating romaine harvested from the six California counties in question. And those counties are Monterey, San Benito, San Luis Obispo, Santa Barbara, Santa Cruz, and Ventura. And if you don't know where your romaine was grown, you probably shouldn't eat it. Like I said, yeah. I'm now a salad eater.
Yeah, well... I should probably eat more salad because they say it's healthy, but it's not the best
choice. I saw a meme about lettuce is always something that people say, eat your salad, yeah. Eat your salad, but what's never recalled is cake.
Yeah. By the way, Peyton's tossing. We know We know you can't see her right now.
It's okay. Joke's on them. I'm always here.
All right. Looks like we are actually going to go to weather this time, Joe.
We are going to go to weather, and we've been talking about dense fog all morning.
Yeah, we have.
But the forecast doesn't get much better. We have heavy rain. On the way tomorrow. We'll break it all down here. It's going to be kind of a choppy forecast as we head through the next 48 hours. Obviously, we've been talking about dense fog. As you look here over McKinley Avenue, you can see still dense fog in place over the Ball State campus. Visibility is improving a bit as we head through the morning. Some of that fog starting to burn off a bit. Temperatures right now, though, at 39 degrees, so you'll still want the coat as you head outside, but it does feel significantly different than it has the last few days. Like we said previously, temperatures warmer than they were just a few mornings ago, which is a welcome change for a lot of us here in central Indiana. We do have dense fog advisories, again, in place until 10 a.m. this morning. Freezing fog advisories in place to the north, but I think that temperatures are now above freezing to the point where just expect dense fog as you head across east central Indiana. Some showers were around this morning. Some of our northern counties may have seen some precipitation. That has very much dissipated. I guess the rest of east central Indiana, the good news is, as you head through the day, we should stay mostly dry. Fog tracker does show improving conditions here across east central Indiana. That said, I would still take a few extra minutes as you head to class today or to work, as we'll likely still see some dense fog around, causing your travel time to be reduced a bit. We have at the bottom of our screen some schools in the area that are seeing delays due to the fog this morning. And also, we've seen some delays at Indianapolis International Airport as a result of the dense fog. The good news is it will burn off as we head through the morning hours. Temperatures warm up to 44 degrees today, so not a big warm up, but again, a welcome change from the much cooler temperatures we've seen the last few days. It'll be mostly cloudy as we head through the afternoon hours. Winds will be a little breezy as we head through the day, but I don't think that will be anything too significant. Tonight, temperatures only back down a few degrees, 41 degrees by 9 o'clock, and by 11 o'clock, we'll still be hanging around that 41 degree mark. Expect mostly cloudy skies as we head through the night tonight. Shift now to Saturday morning. That is a big shield of rain that we're expecting to see moving in to the state as we head through about 4 or 5 a.m. for your Saturday. It will be affecting us in the viewing area here by about 8 a.m., 7, 8 a.m. So if you have any early plans for your Saturday, you'll want the umbrella and you will want to plan some extra time because this rain will likely be fairly heavy as it falls. It looks like our number one risk will likely be heavy rainfall with this system. Rain sticks around through the morning hours, and I think we'll likely see rain around even as we head into your lunch plans for Saturday. And guess what? We could even see a few more rounds of rain around for your dinner plans on Saturday. So if you're not a fan of the rain, this ain't the best forecast, but it'll work, I guess. We'll see temperatures warming, rainfall as much as an inch across the state tomorrow. This is the most significant rain that we've seen in a while. I do think we could see a low-lying flooding threat across portions of Indiana tomorrow, especially with the ground being as frozen as it has been. 56 degrees, the high temperature tomorrow. Again, it will be wet. Grab the umbrella as you head out. If you're planning to head to Indianapolis tomorrow for the Big Ten Championship game, I think the roof is most definitely going to be closed at Lucas Oil Stadium. Still some rain showers lingering around. Temperatures in the upper 50s. If you're heading out there, maybe to tailgate early before the game or something like that. Northwestern and Ohio State playing tomorrow in the Big Ten Championship game. So if you're making the trip to Indy, again, just maybe some showers around. The rest of the 7 day, it's not too bad. We won't see a lot of sunshine as we get past Saturday and Sunday, but 53 degrees here for Monday, 40 degrees here for Tuesday, and we'll see cloudy skies through the rest of the extended forecast. And then cold returns as we head towards the end of the week. So
it's getting about that time for the cold to stick around, isn't it?
Yeah.
Tomorrow marks the first day of December.
Yeah. Ooh, I didn't even realize that.
It does with those higher temperatures too. It's insane. Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
Well, especially when we saw the snow earlier this week. I mean.
Yeah.
We live in Indiana. What can we expect?
Yeah, snow, rain, everything.
Exactly. But right now, a look at trending. And speaking of flying, airplanes flying over southwest portions of the Lake Michigan caused a rare winter phenomenon to occur. Take a look at this. A swirling band of snow quickly formed and then dissipated just over the city of Chicago. This band of snow formed as planes were descending into Chicago and the clouds were enriched in moisture with temperatures below freezing. By a process called inadvertent cloud seeding, parts of the airplane, like the propellers and wings, cut through the cloud and cause formation of ice crystals. These crystals quickly condense and a form of a band of snow was formed. But I mean, it's pretty interesting to even see.
Yeah.
That airplanes can pick up technology like this, but another rare winter phenomenon was observed by Valparaiso, Indiana radar. This image shows a darker enhanced band of snowfall that is supported by industrial particles from steel mills to the north of Gary, Indiana. Both of these winter phenomenon are quite rare and did not impact the overall accumulations of snowfall, but they were a neat sight to see for sure, observing winter precipitation on radar. So, pretty interesting to see.
Yeah, very interesting.
We keep learning all of these different technologies that we are able to pick up, especially going back and forth from snow to rain. Mm-hmm. And now we're going to be seeing even more rain this weekend.
Yeah, I know.
Absolutely. All right, interesting stuff and trending as always, Peyton. Thank you. Just ahead, find out how one Chinese scientist made history in a very interesting way. You won't want to miss it.
That's all after your weather now. Hour. A beautiful look down McKinley Avenue. You can see the bell tower off in the distance being covered by that blanket of fog. Meanwhile, back inside the Ball State Weather Center, Chinese state media reports that authorities have halted the gene editing activities presented by Chinese scientist He Zhuankui. The scientist claims to have created the first genetically edited babies and defends his work. At a genome summit in Hong Kong Wednesday, Dr. He Zhuankui said he was proud of altering the genes of twin girls so they could not contract HIV. In his work, which he announced earlier this week, has not been verified, and many scientists are condemning it. Reports say China has stated that the research violates Chinese law, and gene editing is banned in most countries.
Yeah, some very interesting stuff there. Also in Australia, thousands of students are protesting against the federal government. Take a look at this. They are urging it to take action on climate change. An estimated 15,000 people under 18 years of age were expected to rally in 30 locations. The student group School Strike for Climate Action calls for curbing fossil fuel projections, especially a controversial coal mine in Queensland. Prime Minister Scott Morrison was criticized for calling the students out, saying in Parliament, "What we want is more learning in schools and less activism." So again, some very interesting stuff there. Let's switch gears now and take a look at your national weather. Good morning to you, Hannah Stettler.
Taking a look at current temperatures right now, we are cool in most areas. We're seeing 27 in Denver, 25 in Billings, 31 in Minneapolis, 39 here in Muncie, but down south, we have 65 in Dallas, 52 in Atlanta, and right here is where we are going to see some showers and storms later today and the potential for some severe weather. Taking a look at current watches and warnings, we have a dense fog advisory and freezing fog advisory here in the Midwest. Here, also in the Midwest, we have this big area of winter storm warnings and winter storm advisories and watches throughout today where they could see a few inches of snow possible. Taking a look at current radar, we do have this system of rain down to the south, and down here is where they do have that potential again for severe weather later today. Let's go ahead and break down that severe weather threat for you. We do have an enhanced risk of severe weather through parts of Arkansas, Louisiana, and Texas, where they could see damaging winds, large hail, and even a few tornadoes are possible as we get into the afternoon and evening hours. So if you are heading out that way, just make sure to keep an eye on the weather and be safe as these threats are possible today. Tanner and Tyler, back to you guys.
All right, thank you so much, Hannah. Up next, we break down the science behind wind chills. See, I don't really understand
wind
chills.
Yeah, neither do I.
I guess we'll find out. All right.
Yeah, that's all after your weather now. Back now, just a few minutes before 8:30, you're taking a live look right now down McKinley Avenue.
Still beautiful shot as always.
Yeah, still beautiful. A little bit of fog this morning, and who knows, maybe we're dealing with some wind chill action out there? Yeah, I don't know if we are, because neither one of us know anything about wind chills.
Yeah, Peyton actually just explained what that was to me.
We both felt dumb.
But Jordan Nienaber is over at the whiteboard with breaking down the science behind wind chills. Good morning, Jordan.
Good morning, guys. Yeah, Tyler, it is a little bit... Yeah. We're starting to warm up to where we're starting to see no wind chill, but the winds are also calm, so we can't see a wind chill. But wind chill mainly comes from the fact that when winds blow over, like, your body, it is able to take some of that warm air that we radiate and just move it away. But let's take a look at an example if we have no wind. So normally our body would just radiate warmth, and it will just stay in our bodies, especially in our layers, because air has a quality to where it insulates pretty well, and it doesn't take a lot to move it. But let's say we do have the wind come through, and we have this, and it actually blows away quicker. So that means your body has to give out more heat to be able to make up for that difference. And that's why, like, when it gets really windy, you can feel really cold, because that warm air does have to be replaced. Now, wind chills don't really become a factor until we get to about negative 18, 19, and then we can start to see wind chills or frostbites happen really quickly. But we won't see any wind chills for this weekend, but we do have some rain coming in. Joe, tell us more about that.
Well, thank you for that, Jordan. Yeah, I don't think we'll see anything in terms of substantial wind chills across the state today. Temperatures only warming up a few degrees, though. As the fog burns off this morning, we'll see temperatures 44 degrees, mostly cloudy throughout the rest of the day. And we've corrected the 7-day forecast for you. Again, rain here for Saturday, not Sunday. I think Sunday actually won't be too bad of a day around the area. Mostly cloudy skies expected into the start of next week. But look at those temperatures as we get to Tuesday, Tanner. Just what you love, cold temperatures. Cold temperatures back in the forecast to close out the 7-day. So after a little taste of maybe some more fall-like weather, we're going to dip right back into the more wintry feel by the end of the week. And it makes sense. We're going to move into the first week of December.
Yeah, we sure are.
It is December, but I'd rather it be warm.
Same. All right, guys, thanks so much. And that's all for Cardinal Weather for this Friday morning. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, also be sure to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. We'll see you next week for our holiday special.